are receptive for what goes around, goes around. He works by yi kai.
What by like what?
New works by yi kai. I would like to introduce our speakers for our talk. The title of the talk this afternoon is Interior and Exterior Landscapes in a Global World. First, I want to introduce our artist, Yi Kai. He was born in 1955 in Changsha, China. And he showed an affinity for art at a very early age. And in 1970, at the age of 15, he was drafted into the People's Army at the height of the Cultural Revolution. He spent 9 years building railways in the countryside and creating art propaganda for the People's Republic of China. And in 1979, he was chosen as one of 35 from 4,000 applicants to attend the Art Institute of the Army of China in Beijing. And there he earns a BFA in traditional Chinese painting. During the late 1970s and early 1980s, as China opens to the West, he became exposed to Western culture, particularly American culture. And in 1989, with the assistance of the Midwest China Center in Minneapolis, Yi Kai immigrated to Minnesota. During the last 20 years, his art has transitioned from his artistic education in China to abstract and colorful works that reflect the influence of American culture and expression that informs current direction. Next, I would like to introduce David Pagel, Professor David Pagel. He's an LA Times art critic and a professor of art theory and criticism at Claremont Graduate University in the United States. He's curated many shows, including this one, and he's also contributed to a lot of essays, and he's written books as well on art. He's also written for publications such as Art Forum, Freeze, and Art in America. He's a graduate of Stanford University, as well as he has a master's from Harvard. Thank you, both of you, for coming, especially from California, to be here with us this afternoon. And I'm extremely grateful to be able to participate in this exhibition. It's actually a traveling show which began at Claremont University in California, and then went to Guangzhou to 53 Museum, which is Mr. Lee's museum over there. And finally, it's arrived here in Hong Kong at our gallery. So without further ado, I'd like to invite two speakers to begin.
Thanks so much. What I thought I would do is say a few words about the shows I put together with Yi Kai's work, and then say a few things about the work, and then ask Yi Kai some tough and difficult questions about his art, and then open it up to questions from the group. So I'm gonna start with the title of the show. I called it What Goes Around, Goes Around, because when I started putting together the show, I thought it would be perfect to call it What Goes Around, Comes Around, partly because Yi Kai started out in Asia, and then ended up in North America, and then this was kind of the going back to Asia, so that'd be like this big full circle. But the more I thought about it, the less appropriate that seemed, especially with his work, because for me the idea that what goes around comes around has this kind of like, if you do something good in the world, something good will quickly come back to you, or will eventually could come back to you, and I think, or if you know, if you're a miserable, wretched person and do horrible things in the world, you will eventually be punished for that. That's kind of the karmic ideal that I was starting with, and I thought that as an artist, you don't have that. It doesn't always work out that way. But I think a huge part of being an artist in a global world is that you constantly put things out in the world and. May not ever get repaid for that. And I think that a huge part of being an artist is this kind of endless generosity, where you pour your life and your soul and your vision into things and you put it out there, and maybe people pick up on that and get something out of that, but it doesn't always come back to you. So I wanted to change it kind of from this thinking of kind of a closed circular model of you do one thing and it gets back to you, to as an artist you put things out there and it it keeps going around and other people may pick up on them, but much more of a kind of a tributaries going out and out and out rather than circling back in and closing down. And especially with Dikai, I think he's like, he's got this boundless energy and optimism, and is giving and giving and giving. And then I think that that actually doesn't just go back to him, but goes out further in the world. Another thing I wanted to say about his work, one thing that really interested me as a critic working in Los Angeles, is that I when I looked at this pile of paintings on rice paper that he made over the past 2 years, a lot of them kind of sorted themselves into series, and then there were outliers where they didn't fit into series. And to me, that struck me as something really different from a lot of the work I had been looking at, where to me, either an artist either always worked in series or always worked kind of like singular works that were meant to be non-serial. And to me, the serial artist would set up a structure or a format or a theme or an idea or a media and work within those a certain set parameters or variables and kind of see what could come out of that closed set and then kind of work through it and move on to another series. And then by contrast, of the artists who like in every single piece wanted to do something new, so that what it was actually it went against their goals to work in a series to repeat themselves. And to me, it's almost like an introvert and an extrovert. There's really different kind of characters that work that way. But in Ikai's case, I really felt that he was doing sometimes working as a serial artist and sometimes working as a non-serial artist. And I found that working those two things together was really interesting. And I thought it may have had something to do with being from one culture and living in another culture. But to me, there was this kind of a never letting anything settle into one thing. And to me, that's one of the most exciting parts of his work. I think that that all of the works in this group really kind of have four sorts of spaces in them. I think that there's the space of the human figure in these works, kind of the body. There's also then the kind of the space of architecture or buildings, and then building into cities. And then I think there's also the space of nature coming through in some of them, especially in this one. And then I also think there's kind of the space of the machine or the digital technology. A lot of the paintings are titled Circuit World, and I think that there's these kind of complex, interwoven, vast networks that Ikai is exploring in these works. And I think that to me there's something really interesting that he can kind of fold bodies and architecture and cities and nature and digital space all into one place where it makes sense, but it never collapses into together. To me, it doesn't become this mush where it's all one, that each kind of has its own room and kind of jostles together with the other ones and leaves them alone. So to me, there's this kind of like frisson or dissonance or freedom among the different spaces. You can flip them up. And I think that to me leads to another thing that is maybe kind of the political side of the work. I know that most art that's talked about in terms of political art has a message or an agenda and wants to tell you what to think. And one of the things I love about Ikai's work is it will never ever tell you anything. In terms of like being an instructor or a teacher or a lecturer or a prophet. It's not about telling you what to think. I think his work is always about inviting you to think for yourself. And I think that especially in the times we're living in now, and in the US particularly, where our politics have become so divisive and so divided, it's either this or that. There's no middle ground. And I think that what one of the things that's working in Ikai's work is that there's no single way to see anything. And for me, that's kind of the one of the big consequences of the work is that it insists that that the world is such a complex place, and that reality is so multi-layered, and that human identity is so complex and nuanced, that there's no single way to take anything in. And I love that in these pieces he kind of gives you a bunch of different perspectives, or a bunch of different visions, or a bunch of different realities, and in those realities lets you move around, but no single one is adequate for comprehending everything. And I think that that's one part of being a cultivated human being, is that you can leave room in yourself for conflict and contradiction and irresolution and confusion. And I think we're also living in times where people are kind of against confusion, or think that confusion is something bad that has to be cleared up as quickly as possible. And one thing I love about Ikai's paintings is that they're a mess in a really good way, and that they don't have, they're meant to be looked at over long periods of time. And one thing I really like about the work is that there's not a quick answer or a message. It's really something that you're meant to live with and see different things. And I just this evening being here for an hour or so has been really fun, because usually when I go see galleries, I basically race through them, try to humor I can from the work and move on. And these works are really rewarding for me, and kind of like how slow they are and how that builds up. I also think that the part of the kind of multiplicity or diversity or non-singularity of the work has to do with the way that they're painted, that there's no single one has any one way of representing or depicting or rendering the world. You'll get drips, pores, splashes, puddles, and then you can even tell where you did it flat and moved it around. And then you'll also get kind of almost like these stencil figures, these little diagram chromatic figures. There's some real atmospheric places where it's thin washes, particularly in the one on the front wall. And there's other where it's really thick, opaque places. There's also, you can see where he's taken the palette knife and scraped things around and cut things, especially in this one, where it first looks like a singular space, but then it actually fractures apart into a much more collage, like almost a cubist space is lurking under there. And I think that it's all of those multi-layered elements in the work that draws me to that. Check my notes to see what I missed in my speedy and energetic spewing. And the title of my talk about interior and exterior spaces kind of goes right along with that, where a lot of times when I'm looking at Ikai's paintings, I think this is a mountain, maybe with a urban grid over it, or the computer network over it, but I do feel like I'm looking out into the world. And I think that in other ones, or even in the same ones, I also think he's giving us an internal landscape. And I think that he's doing something really interesting with these two spaces between kind of an interior, reflective, subjective space, and a more public, social, exterior, objective space. And I think those two things come together and hover around each other, and never completely align, but never completely fall apart. So there's an overlap between the two. And I think that has a lot to do with Ikai's work, which is, I think, also kind of a powerful meditation on what it means to be an individual in a mass society. So it's like there's, to me, there's uniqueness and individuality and subjectivity, but it's also a profound knowledge that that's connected to being part of a larger species, that it's that there also is anonymity and identity built up, tied together. So that's my quick thumbnail speed tour of my take on Ikai's work. And before I start asking him questions, I think it's only fair if I ask you if you want to ask me any questions. Nope, good, okay, no. I'm happy to take any questions at all. Or if you want to think a little bit before you ask me.
I wanted to ask you, I think I briefly asked you already before about the East-West mix, kind of how you looked at Ikai's paintings, if they were more, you felt like they were more Eastern or Western, and how, because he was trained in traditional Chinese painting and also oil painting back in China, but then he went to the U.S., and so I'm wondering how you see, as an American, how you see his paintings.
There's so much going on in Los Angeles now about people want to find the perfect hybrid, where they like want to take two ingredients from here and two ingredients from here and put up and you can, and it adds up to five. And there is something to that, but a lot of times it gets played out in such a kind of an illustrative way, and almost it's just kind of clunky and literal. And I do think that Ikai's particular personal history plays into this work a lot. I think that's a great question, because there's, you know, undoubtedly to me, these are paintings coming out of the US, but undoubtedly to me also, there's more than just that brewing in them. And I think the way that the two, if maybe the East and the West, or his past and his current situations, kind of fit together in these, is the kind of spaces they get going. There's a lot of kind of energetic gestural abstraction, but in the U.S., usually that's tied with kind of a self trying to express itself and to blurt itself out and to define itself. And I think in Ikai's case, that there's still that there's that gestural energy, but it's been separated from any kind of expressive individuality, and to me it's more of a meditative space, or kind of, I think that, maybe this is a good way to say it, it's more about kind of letting gravity do its work in the paintings, rather than letting his hand do the work, just from literally like putting this paint down and letting it move this way, and to me it's that he has putting some distance between his self as something you express by screaming things out, and letting himself be kind of more of a passive conduit for other things to flow through it. And I think they're much more atmospheric than a lot of American messy painting. And so I think back to kind of traditional classic landscape paintings, and kind of make washes and that sort of stuff. So I think that it is brewing together, but I like that it doesn't resolve into like a neat fusion. Like it's not like putting it in a blender and you get this global puke. It's parts and fragments. If no one has any questions for me, I will start asking you my questions. And I thought it was great you gave the kind of the quick thumbnail sketch of his biography. And that's what I wanted to put you on the hot seat now, Ikai. And you've been at it a long time. And by at it, I mean making art for a long time. And what I would like to know, and this, I didn't prepare him in advance for this, because I didn't want to have like kind of rehearsed canned answers. So he's getting this at the same time you are. And I was wondering, when did you realize you were an artist? And what was that like, and what did you want from art? So real simple.
Okay. I think that, thank you for coming, everyone. And before I answer the question, I want to say thanks for Alice King. And we know each other for over 30 years. And Alice King always take care of me and give me a lot of help and advice for my art career. And also, I need to thank you, David and Daphne and Mr. Lee, and they put the three locations so and traveling so together. with them, without them, how this is not easy, impossible. Okay, for your question. I think I'm very young, and probably just a few years old, then I started painting. And then during the Cultural Revolution, and I'm 15 years old at that time, and the children of the graduate from middle school only have two choices. One choice, go to the countryside, working with farmer. Another choice is go to army, and because I can do that little bit of painting, so then I go into the army. So that is for almost 9 years. So without the formal education, just training by yourself. Finally, after the reform, then I had a chance to go into the college. So I don't have another choice, so but I like the painting, so keep going. So until now, this is almost 45 years.
So when you, did you just start drawing first? What was the... Just at home, goofing around?
Yes, goofing around. And remember, my mother is always criticizing me draw a lot of paintings on the wall.
And did you know that this was something special or something meaningful, or was just you liked making a mess on the walls?
I think for me, probably I saw something, I have desire to express myself. Mm-hmm. So then I just draw on the wall, or find a paper, draw on the paper. Mm-hmm. So that's just the very originally the idea I want to do something, mm-hmm, and express myself. Mm-hmm.
And at that time, did you know that there was such a thing in the world as artists, and that was something you wanted to be, or was that a foreign notion?
No, I think at that time, in the middle school, mm-hmm, I do the propaganda art. Mm-hmm. So then by chance, I go into the army. Mm-hmm. So in the army, 9 years, I always do the propaganda art. Mm-hmm. And I don't have any idea about the impressionist art and no. I think I remember I first read the Van Gogh and Monet's book. Mm-hmm. It's 1978. Mm-hmm. At that time, I'm already 23 years old. So that's the beginning to learn about Western art. And in the beginning, I cannot understand why they're painting like this way, because the Chinese traditional training since 1949 always influenced by Russia. So the art become more like propaganda. Yeah. So not art by yourself. You cannot express yourself. That's the big problem. So then for me, this 25 years life experience in the United States, so I learned how to express yourself. Mm-hmm. That's a bigger person. Mm-hmm. Yeah, bigger person. Yes.
So would you say that as a little kid, messing around at home, you felt there was some kind of self-expression, mm-hmm, happening, and then that talent got you into the military, and you started doing the propaganda, and did that feel self-expressive, or that felt...
No, like work.
No, that was work. Yeah.
At that time, I think it's mostly about the propaganda work, mm-hmm, because the official gave a title. Mm-hmm. Then the artist just follow the title, trying to do something to express that title. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So it was better than being in the field as a farmer, mm-hmm, and better than being shot at, making the propaganda. But but little by little, that got frustrating, or you?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think it's a big lesson for me is my professor in my graduate school, and Mr. Liu Bingjiang. His professor is Dong Xiwen. He died in 1971, and Dong Xiwen is considered the first art master in oil painting in China. And before. In the 49, he do the like the painting. In the 45, is very like the quickest and very Western influence. So then from 49 until he died, he painting a lot of Chinese propaganda idea. So he died. And before he died, he told my professor that if he have time to painting eventually, he want to painting some like the before the 49, the 45. Mm-hmm. So at that situation, I learned if you always follow the political leader and doing something for political and propaganda, you will lose yourself. So that start that time in 88, 87, I started painting some of the minority people's subject.
Oh,
yeah. So that before it come to the United States.
And so what, would you say you immigrated to the US because of art?
Yes, yeah, yes. I think that after 20 years living in the United States, living in China, I'm thinking that in the United States is another life experience for me. So then I tried to go to the United States, but in the first few years, I don't understand anything about the American culture.
Even English.
Yes. Yeah, even English. I cannot make a phone call when I land in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
So then the little by little, and the most important lesson for me is always deal with the Caucasian and deal with Americans, learn the language, learn the culture.
Yeah.
So then slowly to understand what is different between these two cultures.
Mm-hmm. And so, since you've been in the U.S. from the moment you arrived to now, how has your understanding of art changed?
Okay. First few years, I painting a lot of subject is still is like Tibet, because then and also Egypt, and also at that time I need to support the family, so I need to make money and teaching. So then after the few years.
Is that true?
So in 1995, I started to change the subject because at that time you start the global economic. So the first group of work is American symbols and the Chinese symbols mixed together. So I just thought that if for the human beings, the future, because the global economic and each different culture and the people need to learn each other. So that's my first group of abstract work. Then the second question is that if we try to doing this for the global mix together and culture learn each other, what is the best place to do it? So then I think probably the best place is the United States. I think it's a different system and also the immigration transition. So then the painting, that's why I painted some of the American flags and maps. So that's until 2000.
Yeah.
But the big change for me is after September 11, 2001. So at that time, I think a lot of value about American, about the whole world is pressed.
Right.
So then I figure out and very frustrated for almost 10 years trying to find what I want to do. So, and also in here, and a special thank you for my wife. And he let me to do it, and I just do what I want to do, and they said, don't push me, say you need to make sales, you need to make money. So I'm free then for almost 15 years, just tried my best for myself. So this is why that result is in here.
And so when you said that prior to September 11th, you had found this kind of art was a place you would go for freedom, and then after that, it didn't seem to work out? Did your understanding of art change? Or did your understanding of art's relationship to society change?
I think for my life experience, 15 years old, I go to the countryside, it's very poor, the people's life experience, the condition, and all the way to the United States. So I see a lot of difference between each different people. So for my subject, I always want to do the work. It's not just a surface about the nature. I want to do something in my heart and about the human condition. And so that is my most of the subject comes from, so you can see my work. So those kind of work still is involved with my impression about the human being right now, is my feeling. So for the art, I think American still is the best place to let you do the art. You can try what you want to do, and also the materially, not like China, that now the people compare so much. Every artist want to get more money and get more big name. But in the United States, I can hide in my studio, and for 10 years, I don't care anything. I just do what I want to do. So I think the studio is a good place for me to do it. Mm-hmm.
And so when you say like from 2001 for about 10 years,
yes.
You would go to the studio, make work,
yes.
Be unsatisfied with it, destroy it,
yes.
Go to the studio, make more work, be unsatisfied with it, destroy it. Mm-hmm. So what changed in 2011, 2012?
Okay, yeah, that, I think that the first group after September 11, my subject is more criticized about mm-hmm. unlimited materialism mm-hmm. and also it's unlimited and individualism. So then in the beginning, I painted a lot of the garbage, landscape work and the huge, mm-hmm. and oil on the canvas. And then a few years, then thinking, and who made those garbage is a human being. It's not the garbage themselves. So then I did some group work about the human figures. And that I have some drawings. I stayed there for a few years. But I think that group work is looks too straight.
Mm-hmm.
And just like the propaganda was just like the people, okay. That's what I'm thinking about. You just look it.
Mm-hmm.
So, but those kind of work, I think I hide my idea more into the painting, and then let people read and look the painting, and then read the title, and find some symbols, and then let people they have some time to create something and by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm doing, so that it changed. That is from past 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's little by little, and from very straight,
mm-hmm.
and then also very, then it comes slowly to today.
Mm-hmm. So, what do you know now that you wished you knew 20 years ago?
20 years ago. I wish. I think probably I study more English, and also if I have chance in the beginning of a few years, probably I come to university to study with you for a few years, I get a degree, then I can learn more about American culture.
Mm-hmm.
So for now, I understand American culture and American art.
Mm-hmm.
It's taken me 25 years to figure out. If I have a chance in the beginning, I take 2 or 3 years and learn from the American professors and the students, I can learn more, I can quickly more understand it deeply about American culture. Yeah.
And so your last show here was 15 years ago?
Yes, yes. 2000, yes.
And can you say anything about what it's like to this show now and that show later?
Okay. Yeah. First of all, I'm older, and
not
yes,
so much.
I have more experience, and also at that so it's more before the September 11, and still is the cultural symbols between Chinese symbol and American symbol, how to mix together, and now I think it's probably the subject and everything is more deep inside, and that you can see. Looks like it's very colorful, looks like the Western painting, but actually exactly the deep inside, the philosophy is still from the traditional Chinese painting. And this is not a pure abstract. So it looks abstract, but still you can see something inside, just like when the art master in China said it's the best way is not real. And the best ways between real and unreal. So they have a space to create art, and also they have space to let people to learn and understand. Yeah.
That's beautiful. And I think that's a good moment to see if anyone has any questions before you come.
Yes.
You got me, please. Which is your favorite one?
Yeah, and like that piece is my last one.
Okay.
The last one I did before I come to China.
Oh,
yeah. that one and this one, these two, the last two pieces.
And why is it your favorite?
that one, I think is the color is more transparency. More transparency and also the more back to the Chinese traditional technique. But the color still is the Western color. And the title is the golden figure dancing on the dream garden. Yeah, just the small figures, like the sign, like small people, and in the dream, the garden. It's like the autumn garden represent the rich family, or rich the season, yeah.
That one?
Why do you like that one? That one is a landscape, and the mountain is the very the traditional subject for Chinese painting. And like the Song Dynasty, Yuan Dynasty painting, they're always the big mountain and the small figure in the old traditional paintings. But this one, I follow that kind of philosophy, big mountains, and the people's inside are very small. But the mountains changed because of high tech. And all that now is like the internet, iPhone, and just like the circled city, circled world, and the people that inside sometimes get lost.
Yeah.
So that's the subject of that.
Thank you. Sorry about the question.
No, I like the question. Okay, I was just thank you for your ask.
Thank you very much, both of you, again, for being here.